Good. So hi everyone who I'm speaking to and engaging with live. It's Aaron. I am going to see this on YouTube later. I want to talk about human rights video on YouTube. As we've seen in the Arab Spring, of the 48 hours every minute uploaded to YouTube, a significant part of that is human rights video. And even beyond the Middle East, everyday witnessing of human rights violations, documentation is increasingly commonplace. And so my video for Perpetue is a medley, that's better yet a remix video from YouTube and other online video sources, to show how this video sometimes is very much like other YouTube videos and online videos and made by very typical YouTube users. And it's preoccupied with popular culture, with music, with sharing. And sometimes it's resolutely local, it's specific, it's rooted in other traditions of film and video, or it's finding new forms. So let me share this medley of human rights video with you. So one of the things about this video is it's shot by bystanders and by purposeful witnesses. So this is a video from forced evictions in France. But just as disturbingly, and I think this is important, is it's shot by the perpetrators. So here's the Iraqian police force rover boys to hit each other. And it's often also as much about individuals speaking out as it is about that kind of graphic brutality. So here it's a survivor of a massacre in Brazil. Or here it's just this very simple demonstrative act. I love this. Someone driving in the street in Saudi Arabia. Why would that be a crime? Or it's a simple act like this in Lebanon of showing the racial discrimination against a maid at a pool. It just shows that the video is not just about that graphic violence that you see in the street in Syria. It's about those subtle violations and the subtle patterns of life. I love that in a video like this from Indonesia, we learn about the decisions to go and become a maid in Saudi Arabia. And it's very local as well. Sometimes we always think about YouTube and other online spaces as being for us. This is a video from another human rights space called the Hub about hospital rights in the Philippines. And then we see the same forms that we use to remix cute cats or to remix pop videos taken into the streets of somewhere like Iraq. This is one of those tremendously powerful videos from Iraq. We'll hear from Egypt. This was an act of solidarity to create videos like this. You know, Egyptians living abroad would create videos from the footage on the streets, remix and share and track online. And these images became iconic almost in the moment. And then sometimes it's just the simplest of forms. This is the form that you run into everywhere on YouTube and online spaces, the video blog. And here it's Asma Mahfouz, who many people credit with helping spark the Tahrir Square, sitting in her room, calling on people to come out and do something. And of course, the most basic form of human rights footage, dating back to things like Rodney King's, that moment when someone captures an atrocity here in Bahrain, the moment after a shooting. Or here in Libya, leading out, trying to work out what is going on in the street. Who are these people? What are they doing? And the one aspect that has been tremendously powerful over the last 4 or 5 months in the Middle East is seeing how people have overcome the challenges of a space like YouTube or Facebook to aggregate and pull together lots of different voices. So we don't just see a single screen. We see in something like this, this is a site called Crowd Voice, all kinds of social media updates pulled together in one place. Or in something like this, Storify. We see a narrative that has YouTube posts and Facebook. And of course, even on YouTube itself, CitizenTube is collating together and putting together whole lists of human rights video. It's overcoming the challenge of YouTube, which is the contextualization, the absence of ways of seeing how multiple stories link together. And so let me just end with a question, maybe you in the room and to people on YouTube, is how we tap into those tremendous powers of online video that are around accessibility and malleability and spreadability, and the way this creates the opportunity for us to see this footage from Egypt and Libya and Syria. At the same time, how do we understand what is true? Whose point of view is being shown? How do we know that those images make any difference? And whose responsibility is it to make sure that we have the ability to do that? Does that ability rest with us, just as the people who watch it? Does it rest with the people who create it? And how much responsibility rests with a space like YouTube, with that 48 hours of footage being uploaded every minute and all this human rights footage? So let me leave you with that question, both for you there and for this video. Thank you.
Also. once more. So it's kind of a bit of a shoulder. It's not sure from the reader's standpoint, from the viewer's standpoint, what is really true. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing, you really need some more.
Right.
So when you need a lot of it, you know, understand that matters. Mm-hmm.
So taking out of context, these specific instances and images that you have to look at in multiple ways, it's just a framework which is a framework which you. What about the idea of showing such a the verb that is performed within the other context? I mean, how does that happen? I mean, what's the same way of doing the other verb? And it's a show that I teach you, but yet it's very specifically for the other. Does it become us, or within by virtue of the context of being in the body, or is it something else?
It is. It's almost like a surreal art, because it heightens it. I feel like watching this in the gallery is a bit more emphasis.
More
completely, potentially, because you assume that whatever you're seeing is chosen for a reason. But I would say we need to power it a bit more.
And what about the way, because obviously, you know, sound plays with this, but this one suture coming together. What about the way we do that? We do have, because I want to have an exhibition with that. With those, you know, this is the sound stage, and the sound of this stage. And it's very, very similar.
I mean, if anything, he was able to explain nuances of citizenship. I didn't know that existed. But then creating this montage of these horrible bad acts, just kind of just in your face almost. Because you see a woman who's speaking on YouTube about human rights and how these people can do that without going to do
that. That's really interesting.
Yeah. And it kind of creates this montage. So you have the power to make exact change to your YouTube.
I mean, in many ways, it's a very exhilarating presentation. I don't know how long I'm going to have an experience. Yeah. That's a good issue. Is there anything that we have anything else to talk about?
I thought it was interesting how he chose not to pull the video from wherever it came from and create his own montage, but to show like the actual like interface where it was, like, whether it's on YouTube or a news site, and I don't know, I just thought that was somewhat significant, showing where all these different forms of video activism can make this point.
Yeah, it's such a great concept.
Yeah, provide a little context, I think, just thinking
Yes.
One thought I had, this video fits into the larger genre that we're doing right now is distraction slash death on YouTube, and the idea of the dualism of videos that have distraction and death, and how those two themes fit somehow into both art and YouTube. And particularly with this, even just watching his video, the sensationalism of violence that's necessary for something to become popular on a site like YouTube, because we're seeing, he's talking about activism and social change through social media content, but even that has a necessity for some type of, not entertainment, but sensationalism of violence. It's someone being shot, or if it's a riot breaking out, or if it's protesters and police, something like that has an element of distraction, of the need for an individual watching it to see something short, something quick, something that is poignant, and then be done with it. And the question I would ask is the ultimate goal of that deep enough to be all right? Is it okay that we view these social change or are working for social change through a network that, because of the way it's set up, we still want the sensationalism of violence or the sensationalism of some type of action?
Quick fix.
Yeah, I
Yeah.
So I think it's, we should maybe suggest we go to the Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much.